morning, everyone. Welcome to this fourth Sunday of Lent. I am Stephanie McKean. It's a big day for us at Aldersgate United Methodist Church. Today, we begin taking steps to return to in-person worship. We are in the sanctuary right now. The sun is actually shining right through the stained glass. So I'm gonna try not to look at it because I might be temporarily blinded here. Coincidentally, it's exactly 1 year ago we left the sanctuary and began various forms of virtual worship. We are so thankful for the technology that has enabled us to continue being the church. Church did not stop. We celebrate opportunities such as the virtual mission trip, a prayer group, Financial Peace University, Cafe Connect, book club, meetings, worship, and so much more. Praise the Lord. Our Lenten series is called Again and Again, a Lenten Refrain. Today's focus is called Again and Again, God Loves First. Jesus waxes poetically when he tells Nicodemus in John 3 that God so loved the world that God sent his Son to restore it. Love is where God begins and ends, even and especially for us. Consider these questions this week during your quiet time with God. What associations or memories do you have related to John 3:16? In the past, perhaps when you first encountered the famous verse, what was the meaning you gleaned from it? What meaning do you glean from it now? Nicodemus comes to Jesus in the night. What questions, longing, or wonderings stir you awake in the night? What is God's redeeming light exposing in the world right now? What is it exposing in your community, your church? How are we being drawn back to the love in the midst of being exposed? The candle is lit, bringing light to our darkness. Let's begin our worship by taking a deep breath. Let God's Spirit fill every part of you, quieting your mind and listening for God's word again and again. Before we were born,
before we took our first breath,
before the week started,
before the year started,
before we said, I love you,
before we said, I'm sorry,
before we figured out who we really are,
before we figured out who we want to be,
before it all,
God loved us
unconditionally and freely,
fully and honestly.
God loved us
again and again. This is where our story begins. Let us worship God.
The seams, it's getting harder and harder to see. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Children's Time. This is Miss Anne, and it's nice to see all the kids today. I'm going to read a story materials suggested. And so this is a story for everyone, but the kids might like it. I got it at the library. It's called Love, and it's by Matt De La Pena, and the illustrations are by someone named Lauren Long. So we're going to read the story together, and you can see the pictures. I'll hold it up. Okay. All right. Hopefully we can see. In the beginning, there is light and two wide-eyed figures standing near the foot of your bed, and the sound of their voices is love. I can't see my picture. So hopefully, can you see the pictures? Can you go like this if you can? All right, thank you. All right. A cab driver plays Love softly on his radio while you bounce and back with the bumps of the city. And everything smells new, and it smells like life. Love, too, is the smell of crashing waves and a train whistling blindly in the distance. And each night, the sky above your trailer turns the color of love. In a crowded concrete park, you toddle towards summer sprinklers while older kids skip rope and run up the slide, and soon you are running among them, and the echo of your laughter is love. On the night the fire alarm blares, you're pulled from sleep and whisked into the street where a quiet old lady is pointing to the sky. Stars shine long after they've flamed out, she tells you, and the shine they shine with is love. But it's not only stars that flame out, you discover, it's summers too, and friendships and people. One day you find your family nervously huddled around the TV, but when you ask what happened, they answer with silence and shift between you and the screen. In your dream that night, you are searching for a love that seems lost. You open and close drawers, lift cushions, empty old toy bins, but there's nothing. When you wake with a start in the arms of a loved one who bends to your ear and whispers, "It's okay, it's okay, it's love." And in time, you learn to recognize a love overlooked, a love that wakes at dawn and rides to work on the bus, a slice of burnt toast that tastes like love. And it's love in each deep crease of your grandfather's face as he lowers himself onto an overturned bucket to fish. And it's love in the rustling leaves of gnarled trees lined behind the flower beds. Actually, I said fields, but it works. And it's love in the made-up stories your uncles tell in the backyard between wild horseshoe throws. And the man in rags outside the subway station plays love notes that lift into the sky like tiny beacons of light. And the face staring back in the bathroom mirror, this too is love. So when the time comes for you to set off on your own, heavy winds will sweep past your building and great gray clouds will congregate above. Your loved ones will stand there like puddles beneath their umbrellas, holding you tight and kissing you and wishing you luck. But it won't be luck you'll leave with, because you'll have love. You'll have love. 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 The end. children of all ages, I hope you know how much you are loved. God made you out of love, so you can share love with others in everything you do. There's nothing you can't do that will make God love you any more or less, because God has loved you from the very, very beginning. Isn't that a really cool gift, everybody? Let's pray together. Dear God, thank you for loving me from the very beginning, and all of us who are here and those who are not with us. Help me to start with love in everything I do and say. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
Call to confession today is inspired by a children's book entitled No, David, by David Shannon. It's the story of a rowdy elementary schoolboy who is constantly getting into trouble. He jumps on his bed, he chews with his mouth open, he plays baseball in the house. Page after page, His mother is yelling after him. No, David. David, stop. David, I said no. Well, at the very end of the book, we see a very sad David. His eyes are brimming with tears, and this time, with his arms wide open for a hug, his mother simply says, yes, David, I still love you. Family of faith, if we were to place ourselves in this story, we would be David. We mess up and make mistakes all the time. However, if we are David, then God would be the mother in the story, constantly saying to us, yes, I still love you. I will always love you. So let us pray together to the God of love, trusting that God loved us first.
God of love, we forget the beginning of the story, that we made from love to be love, to give love. Instead of rooting our narrative in the goodness, refrain of creation, we skip ahead to find our worth at the fall with Cain and Abel, lost in the wilderness. We forget that first there was you, and you are love. We forget that out of love, you created us. We forget that from the very first day, you loved first. We forget because a love like that doesn't make sense to us. Forgive our low self-esteem. Forgive our resistance to love ourselves. Forgive our hesitation to trust that even we could be made good. And forgive our tendencies to pass that doubt on from generation to generation. Write a new beginning for us that roots our confidence in your unrelenting love. With hope we pray again and again. Amen.
Family of faith, no matter what we do, where we go, or what we tell ourselves, God is love, and God is loving us.
Again and again, we are claimed, held, forgiven, and cared for in the name of the lover, the beloved, and love itself. Thanks be to God. Amen. Well, here we are, deep into March Madness, hurling headlong toward the end of Lent. Here and now we prepare ourselves to hear God's word from Paul's letter to the followers of Jesus in Ephesus, chapter 2, the first 10 verses, and from the Gospel of John, chapter 3, verses 14 through 21. What does God have to say to us today after everything we've been through? Plenty. Let's pray. God of the here and now, we have heard the words, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son, time and time again. We have read them on billboards, heard them in worship, and seen them on signs. And yet we know there is a difference between hearing those words in passing and truly, deeply listening. We long to listen, God. We long to hear your truth. We long to know your love. Open our hearts and minds. We are listening. Amen. This is God's word from the letter to the Ephesians. At one time, you were like a dead person because of the things you did wrong and your offenses against God. You used to live like people of this world. You follow the rule of a destructive spiritual power. This is the spirit of disobedience to God's will that is now at work in persons whose lives are characterized by disobedience. At one time, you were like those persons. All of you used to do whatever felt good and whatever you thought you wanted, so that you were children headed for punishment, just like everyone else. However, God is rich in mercy. He brought us to life with Christ while we were dead as a result of those things that we did wrong. We did this because of the great love that he has for us. You are saved by God's grace. And God raised us up and seated us in the heavens with Jesus Christ. God did this to show future generations the greatness of his grace by the goodness that God has shown us in Jesus Christ. You are saved by God's grace because of your faith. This salvation is God's gift. It's not something you possessed. It's not something you did that you can be proud of. Instead, we are God's accomplishment, created in Jesus Christ, Christ Jesus, to do good things. God planned for these good things to be the way that we live our lives. This is God's word from the Gospel of John. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so must the human one be lifted up so that everyone who believes in him will have eternal life. God so loved the world that he gave his only son, so that everyone who believes in him won't perish, but will have eternal life. God didn't send his son into the world to judge the world, but that the world might be saved through him. Whoever believes in him isn't judged. Whoever doesn't believe in him is already judged, because they don't believe in the name of God's only Son. This is the basis for judgment. The light came into the world, and people love darkness more than the light, for their actions are evil. All who do wicked things hate the light and don't come to the light for fear that their actions will be exposed to the light. Whoever does the truth comes to the light so that it can be seen that their actions were done in God.
Thank you, Stephanie. Welcome. I'm Jim Hodge, pastor of the Aldersgate United Methodist Church. A special word of thanks to our techies this morning: Shelley Reinhart, Laura Witkowski, Carrie Albin, Rick Van Horn, Wendy Clark, our liturgist Stephanie McKean, children's time leader Ann Reinhart, and our musician and singer Lori Elliott, and everyone else who shares their talents in the ministry of making these virtual worship services possible. And thank you also, friends, for your continued support of the church, your prayers, your time, your talent, your witness. Your loving dedication and generosity empowers us to be in ministry with one another and in our community. So far in our Lenten series, again and again, we've talked about how God claims us and calls us beloved and calls us into a life of serving, and how we are called to listen, really, really, really listen to God, and how we consider that God's Spirit leads us. And today, we're talking about God's love. Let's pray. Light of the world, hope of all hearts, our hope remains in you, especially when hope seems nearly impossible. Speak to us again and again through your Spirit, your word, your people. Baptize us again and again in your love and sustain us in the hope of the covenant you have written on our hearts. Amen. As Stephanie mentioned, the context in which this famous verse from St. John's Gospel, chapter 3, verse 16, comes is from the conversation Jesus had with another religious teacher, or as they said in the first century, master, named Nicodemus. Nicodemus came to Jesus in the middle of the night, and preachers for centuries now have expounded on theories as to why that was. But there he was in the middle of the night to ask Jesus some very important questions. Questions that he felt he needed to have answered. Truth be told, friends, I am just another clueless, guilt-ridden, doubt-filled religious leader like Nicodemus, stumbling around in the darkness of my own stupidity and my own stubbornness, searching for the truth. There is a lot I don't know. Here's something I do know. The English language is incredibly inept at defining and articulating what it means to love. We have one word, love, which can mean a lot of very different things. In the Bible, for example, there are several words that are used to convey several different qualities of the word love. Eros, that means romantic love. Philia, which means affectionate love, the love of a brother and sister, for example. Storge, which means a familiar kind of love, the love of a place, or that sense of, I don't know, even at times, deja vu in a pleasant fashion. Pragma, an enduring kind of love. Philautia, self-love or self-compassion. Ludos, a playful kind of love. And agape, unconditional love. The highest form of love, according to St. Paul, godly love, the love of God for humanity and of humanity for God. So the word used in that famous verse from St. John's Gospel that frames our worship perspective for today is agape, unconditional love, love no matter what. Now that word, agape, has been expounded on by scores of Christian writers in a specifically Christian context. C.S. Lewis uses that word in The Four Loves to describe what he believes is the highest level of love known to humanity, a selfless love that is passionately committed to the well-being of others. The Reverend Sarah R., one of the authors of our series for Lent, has written a poem that expresses how she understands love. She calls it Hold. If you hold a newborn in your arms, all at once you will understand the crook of your elbow and the cup of your palm as never before. Ordinary curves of the body transformed into a resting space. You were designed for love. And if you're lucky enough to hold a newborn in your arms, and that newborn curls its tiny fingers around yours, making your hands look like the hands of a giant, then time might stand still. And those around you might point and say, look, that little one is holding you back. And in that moment, if you pay attention, you will catch a glimpse of the circle that love was meant to be. God is love, our resting place. With small hands, we hold back. In his first known correspondence with the followers of the Way of Jesus in Metro Corinth, St. Paul attempts to describe what God's love is like. Here are the 16 characteristics he lists in the 13th chapter of 1 Corinthians, with a question for you to consider following each one. God's love is long-suffering, which is really an old-fashioned way of saying, and meaning, a love that has and shows patience in spite of all the troubles it encounters, especially those caused by other people. So the question is, are you patient with others, or are you quickly frustrated with them? Number two, God's love is kind. It's friendly, generous, considerate. Are you kind or harsh in your actions and attitudes? God's love is not envious, is never discontented or resentful at someone else's possessions or qualities or luck. Do you take pleasure in the blessings and accomplishments of others? Or are you jealous of them? God's love does not vaunt. It does not boast about or praise itself. It just is, in smallish ways and in miraculous ways. If we notice, it just is. Do you notice and fulfill others' needs, or do you promote yourself and your needs above others? God's love is not puffed up. It is not prideful or obsessed with its own importance. Do you feel the need to promote your supposed superiority, or are you content to quietly live with and for others? God's love does not behave in unseemly ways. It is not indecent, indecorous, indelicate, inelegant, inept. Are you morally and socially appropriate, or do you make others feel really, really uncomfortable? God's love does not seek its own. It is not selfish or self-seeking. Are you unselfish, or do you use others to fulfill your own needs? God's love is not easily provoked. It is not easily annoyed or angered. Do you delight in helping others, or are you easily irritated and aggravated by their needs? God's love considers no evil. God's love is good all of the time. Even when the circumstances are really lousy, God's love is good. Do you quickly forgive and forget? Or do you take inventory of other people's errors to use against them? God's love does not rejoice in iniquity. It does not celebrate immoral or grossly unfair behavior. Are you pleased when others fail or miss the mark? God's love rejoices in the truth. It celebrates honesty and facts. Do you delight when others learn and follow the truth? God's love bears all things. It does not allow affliction, detriment, insult, offense, or indignity to come upon the object of its affection. This means everything and in all circumstances. There is no feasible situation in which genuine love would fail to cover, fail to protect. So, do you have a limit of what you will endure for others? Or do you trust God to supply the love and grace and strength to endure patiently? God's love believes all things. It gives everyone the benefit of the doubt. Do you look for the good in people or expect the worst? God's love hopes all things. It believes all things, even into the future, into the unknown. Do you expect good in others when they stray from God, or do you give up on them? God's love endures all things. There is nothing that can keep it away. It always is, it always remains, it always perseveres. God's love never fails. It's never lacking or neglectful. It always wins. Agape love does not come from good intentions. It is a byproduct of redemption, spiritual self-awareness, and faithfully living the gospel with and for others. If you have truly loved someone, you will always love them. Does it make sense? Me? Like I said, I'm just another clueless, guilt-ridden, doubt-filled religious leader like Nicodemus, stumbling around in the darkness of my own stupidity and stubbornness. There is so much I do not know. Here's something I do know. A few weeks ago, my father-in-law knew he was nearing the end of his life. COVID-19 has debilitated dying persons and their families in really cruel ways. There are strict limitations on who and how many can have person-to-person access to individuals in the hospital. And we have all heard stories of people who have died alone. My father-in-law wasn't going to let that happen because he knew love, the love of God, agape, and he knew it through his family. So with the help of a loved one in the hospital with him, he made some video calls. Not to say he was dying, because he was still hopeful he could come through all of this and be well. Still, everyone had a chance to speak with him. The last time I saw him was on the video call that we shared. We chatted a bit like we always have, a comfortable sort of awkwardness between two men who don't share the same interests, you know, save for his wonderful daughter, my beloved spouse, and his grandchildren, two of which are our daughters. My father-in-law looked really tired on that call. He hadn't slept for quite a while. Still, he managed his usual modest smile and a bit of conversation. Oh, we could talk about all sorts of things, he and I, on the surface, you know. What do you think about this? What do you think about that? Have you heard about this? How's work going? You know, that kind of thing. But we really never dug that deep about God, about our sense of who we are, about depression. Not like I have with my dad. Still, it was a heart-wrenching experience. And as heart-wrenching as it was, there was also an odd bit of joy. Because far beyond our disconnection, far beyond his hopes and his fear, he knew. He knew love, God's love, agape. He knew it because we lived it together, all of us, as a family. And there was nothing mysterious about it. There certainly wasn't anything miraculous about it. It was who we were together, who we knew we were called to be, our very best selves, living with and for each other, breath by breath, step by step, day by day, year after year. What is mysterious? What is miraculous to me? Is how far into the unknown that love lives transformed, transfigured, resurrected again and again in the blink of an eye. His presence, his voice, his humor, his wisdom lives on. And I will never know the height, the breadth, and the reach of that. When he closed our conversations, he said, "Good luck with the church." Those were his final words to me. He brought all of you up. Good luck with the church. And that odd sense of joy in my heart welled up again. For who he has been in my life? And it synapsed a wonderful translation between my ears. Good luck with the church. What I heard was, "Jim, I never really have gotten, nor do I get, why you chose to do what you do. And I want you to know, I love you." I pray I can hold on to that love for the rest of my life. We come now to a time of prayer, and there are some prayer requests which have been noted as we have been worshiping together. Jeanette Johnson asked for prayers for her brother Jerry. Diagnosis was not what he had hoped. Something about chemo treatment yesterday for an aggressive cancer. Prayers asked by the Caldwells, prays for COVID vaccines for those 16 years old and over. Kathy Hodge asked for prayers for safe travel for our daughter and son-in-law who will be driving up later today. And are scheduled to arrive early in the morning. And prayers for her mother and the rest of the Wettick family as we deal with our grief from the loss of her father. And praise for sunshine and the beginning of spring. Also, we rejoice with Sandy Isley and her family in the success of her surgery, and we continue to offer our prayers for her continued healing. We also remember our homebound Mary Lou Arnold, Arlene Parker, Joanne Ensley, Lois Jessup, and Eleanor Howison. And I do invite you to recite the Lord's Prayer with me at the end of our prayer time. I will be using the word sins. Let's pray. Creator God, infinite love, heart of all life. Your book tells us you love this world into being with such love as to birth yourself among us. Love begotten as the beloved. Opening ourselves to your love, we live beyond our mortal selves and join your eternal oneness. Your presence does not separate. Your love unites. Love does not push away. Love embraces. You do not condemn. You recreate. You redeem. You transform. In trusting this, we know we are loved, never rejected. When our trust fails, we find ourselves in deep trouble. Sometimes we withdraw into ourselves, closing ourselves off to love, the only source of life. Thank you for calling us out, God. Thank you for your good news in Christ Jesus, which teaches us to live among, with, and for others. Empower us even now to choose generosity, to choose compassion, to choose justice over our own self-interest. We practice that good news when we lift up the lives and health of those we've named today and those in our hearts who are in need of your continued peace and healing. Continue to teach us what it means to live as children of the light, generously sharing your abundance with all our brothers and sisters in need. And so we offer this and all our prayers in the name of the one who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
By grace we have been saved through faith and not by keeping law. But saints believed by what they heard and not by what they saw. And not by what they saw. For all have sinned and fallen short, God's plan not one obeyed. As ours for all fulfilled the law, believe, confess, be saved. Believe, confess, be saved. We know the wage of sin is death, thank God we shall revive. For just as Jesus rose again, we too are made alive. We too are made alive. Set free we now have peace with God. Salvation is secured. How beautiful the feet of those who share the gospel word. Who share the gospel word.
Family of faith, let's celebrate what we believe.
We believe God is love, unconditional, constant love. We believe this love exists for all, choosing each and every one of us, day after day, again and again and again. We believe God's love is like a river. Rivers cannot help but flow toward the sea. God's love cannot help but move toward us. We are swimming in it. We believe that God loved first. We believe that God breathed life into dust. We believe that God said, "This is good." And because we believe that God loved first, we strive to build lives that reflect God's love. May we begin again here. Amen.
Mountains and the sea, your river runs with love for me, and I will always.
As we conclude our worship, may your mouth speak of God's goodness. May your arms hold those in need. May your feet walk toward justice. May your heart trust its worth. May your soul dance in God's grace. And may this be your rhythm again and again and again until God's promised day. In the name of the lover, the beloved, and love itself, go with courage, go with heart, go in peace. Amen.